Hello, my friend. God bless you. And hey, he's got something for you. I just preached a message to our church recently that I call the ABCs of Christ's Redemption, a really simple message that I took out of a section of the book of Colossians. Yet there is some vital, vital truth in those verses that we're going to share. So if you got a Bible, grab it, and we're going to look at the ABCs of our Savior's redemption. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers. Hello to everyone that's watching us online or in any other way at any other time. Hello to you. You ready for the word? You sure? All right. Last week, we got into Colossians chapter 2. We're on a series on the book of Colossians right now. And I did verses 1 through 11. Some of the verses we kind of hurried through just because of time and determined then, and we let you know that we're going to come back and spend a little more time on some of those verses, which we're about to do. So if you have your Bible, Colossians chapter 2, and the title of the message is The ABCs of Christ's Redemption. The ABCs of Christ's Redemption. Pretty simple stuff we're going to be looking at today, but it can change your life. Now let's pray and get into the Word. Heavenly Father, we settle our hearts down before You, and we give You our undivided attention. Father, to the best of our ability, each and every one of us, we marshal all of our resources, spirit, soul, and body, and we lean out toward heaven. Speak to us. Cause these eyes of ours to see, these hearts of ours to comprehend. And Father, we ask it with a view to put it into practice. The things that we learn, we're not just going to admire them, but we're going to do them. We know it's one that does the word, that is blessed in his or her deeds. Thank You for the Holy Spirit who's present here to lead and guide us into all of the truth. Lord, we just want to say we love You. Amen. Right, the ABCs of Christ's redemption. A stands for all things new. Can we say that together? All things new. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 11. When you came to Christ, you were circumcised, but not by a physical procedure. Christ performed a spiritual circumcision, the cutting away of your sinful nature. Now, physical circumcision cuts away and removes part of the flesh. But Jesus, when we put our trust in Him, took the sword of the Spirit and cut away the entirety of our sinful nature, that is, in our spirits. Look with me at 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, and I'm sure most of you have heard this. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Well, obviously that all things new is not in our bodies. I still have the same body I had before I got saved. I have an older version now. But I had freckles before I gave my life to Jesus. I had freckles after I gave my life to Jesus. All things new, not talking about my mind. That wasn't changed. What changed was my spirit. You are a spirit being. You have a soul. You live in a physical body. Your soul is comprised of your mind, your will, and your emotions. But the part of you that was saved when you accepted Christ was your spirit. All things became new. God cut away the sin nature from your spirit, the real you. Spirit saved, your soul, mind, will, and emotions, they're in the process of being saved. The book of James, written to believers, said, receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. And then our bodies, well, one day we're going to get a new body, but in the meantime, We have this treasure in earthen vessels. Listen to what Jesus said. He's talking to Nicodemus. One night, Nicodemus was a ruler of the Jews. And in John 3, verse 6, Jesus said, "That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit." Now notice, "That which is born of the Spirit," capital S, "is spirit," little s. The translators got that right. "That which is born of the Holy Spirit is your human spirit." That eternal part of you. He went on and Jesus said, "Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from or where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." In other words, there's an element of mystery with this new birth and this inward all things becoming new. You know, the wind is invisible. I don't know where it's coming from. I can't see it. I don't know where it's going, but I can sure see its effects. I can see the limbs on the trees, you know, bowing before the wind. I can see the leaves being blown along. I see the effect of it, but it's invisible to my eye. Well, you know what? When the Holy Spirit recreated my spirit, it's invisible. You can't see that with your physical eye. There's an element of mystery to it. However, you can see the results. You know, my friends, when I gave my life to Jesus, some of them said, "Look, it looks like Bayless. The voice sounds like Bayless, but there's somebody else living in his body. He's not getting high with us anymore. He's not sleeping with his girlfriend anymore. He doesn't talk the way he used to talk. Something has changed." All right, they couldn't see it physically. There was a bit of a mystery there, but they certainly saw the impact that it had when my spirit was born again through the Holy Spirit. Now, someone might say, "Okay, if all things passed away and all things have become new, if I'm a new person on the inside, if literally my spirit has been born again, then why do I sometimes still want to do bad things? Why do I sometimes struggle with temptations?" Well, you know, Paul wrote about that. In the book of Romans, he said, "I delight in the law of God after the inward man," spirit, the person that's been born again. My spirit wants to obey God. The real me on the inside, I want to line up with the will of God. I want to be pleasing to God. He said, "I delight in the law of God after the inward man." It went on and says, "But I see another law in my members or in my body that's constantly wanting to pull me into sin." You see, my spirit has been born again, but I still have the sin nature in my flesh. I have a new body laid up to my account, but the truth is that there is still a principle of sin in my flesh. Galatians chapter 5 outlines the same struggle. And again, one day we'll have a new body, but in the meantime, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that still have the principle of sin working in them. Listen to these words of Paul in Ephesians 4 and 24. He said, "And that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness." All right, the new man, your spirit, the real you on the inside, has been created, born again, made new in righteousness and true holiness. There's nothing wrong with my spirit. I have been given the righteousness of Christ. I have been touched by heaven's holiness. And yet he said, put it on. In other words, it's like I put this coat on. Wear it outwardly. Get what God put on the inside to the outside. Start living it out. This thing that's inside of you, this new man, this new woman on the inside that's created by God, righteous and holy and good, put it on. Work it out into your speech. Work it out into your attitudes. Work it out into your behavior. And Paul gives us a great clue how we can start doing that. The previous verse, Ephesians 4, 23, he said, "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind." What we do with our minds will determine whether our spirits, our new nature will dominate, or whether our flesh will dominate our lives. It's like you've got your spirit born again, wants to please God, wants to serve God. Your flesh, It just wants to do naughty things. Caught in between is your mind. What you do with your mind will determine which way you swing, with the flesh or with your new born again nature. Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. You probably know these verses. He said in verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body. All right, who's the you? The spirit person on the inside, the real you. You present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Okay, how do I do that? The next verse he tells you. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove, experience what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God. So he said, all right, don't be conformed to this world. The word conform, the Greek word, literally means to be squeezed into a mold by an outside pressure. You know, the world is continually putting pressure on everyone through every means it can to fit in, to accept its values, its views, the acceptable norms of modern culture. There's constant pressure that the zeitgeist of a godless society that threatens to punish you if you do not fit in, that pressure is always there. But he said, listen, don't be conformed to the views and the values and the spirit of the age. He said, but be transformed. Now, the word conformed, the Greek word molded by an outside pressure, the word transformed literally means to let what's on the inside come to the outside. It's the Greek word metamorpho. Does that sound familiar? We get our English word metamorphosis from it. Let what's on the inside come to the outside. All right, how do I do that? I renew my mind with God's word. I change my thinking. I let his word become the final authority in my life. Not what the world says, not what the world thinks, not what the zeitgeist of the age is, but his word. You know, one day, one of the kids came home when they were small with a shoebox from school. In the shoebox, it was a bunch of worms. He said, Dad, these are silkworms. My teacher gave them to me, and we're going to feed them, and they're going to change. I said, what do we feed them? Lettuce? They said, no. I said, what do we feed them? They said, well, the only thing that silkworms eat is mulberry leaves. That's all. I said, we don't have a mulberry tree in our yard. I said, well, Dad, we have to get mulberry leaves. So we scoured the neighborhood, found a neighbor with a big mulberry tree, and we borrowed some of their mulberry leaves. Brought them, threw them in that shoebox. You wouldn't believe. Those silkworms went to town. They gorged themselves, and they became even uglier. In fact, just put picture. This is what a silkworm looks like. Yeah, they're not a real pretty worm. And when they get filled with mulberry leaves, they become sort of this almost translucent green, pudgy, and just even uglier. And then they spun these silk cocoons, and it was just quiet. But it wasn't too long, something amazing came out. These butterfly-like creatures, these silkworm moths. Look and see what came out. Put a picture up there if you would. Yeah, I couldn't believe my eyes. That ugly worm turned to that. We got a couple other pictures. There's different kinds of silkworms. Look what they turn into. They're amazing. I literally was stunned. I think we might have one more picture. You can put it up. Just amazing. But the world will tell you, no, look, you're a worm. You act like a worm, you stay a worm, you're a worm just like the rest of us. And I say, no, Christ has put something better inside of me. And I am going to feed on the mulberry leaves of God's word, and I am going to be transformed. What he put on the inside is going to come to the outside because I renew my mind with his word. My mind and my spirit are going to agree, and they are going to put my body into subjection. And yeah, certainly there's going to be struggles sometimes. Even the great apostle Paul, 1 Corinthians 9:27, said, hey, I discipline my body and I bring it into subjection. Meaning he was saying my body doesn't always want to go along with the program. I like the King James Version. He said, I keep under my body, or I put my body under. You know, when we were kids, if we were in a public pool or at somebody's house that had a pool, when I was little, they used to have these little styrofoam paddle boards. You'd hang on to them and kick your legs. And we used to take them and we'd push them down under the water and stand on them. And those little boards were just wanting to jump out all the time. And whoever could stand on that thing the longest won. That's like your flesh. You're keeping it under. It's wanting to pop out and do something wrong. You know, it's wanting to say something bad. It's wanting to watch something naughty. And I'm keeping it. How do I do that? How do I keep it under? Well, I renew my mind with God's word. I feed my heart with God's word. And my life and actions and speech are going to go in line with this recreated nature on the inside. Somebody says, you ever going to mess up? Well, yeah, but the more we mature in Christ, those become fewer and farther in between. It's called maturation. It's called growing in spiritual maturity. It's called growing in Christ's likeness. And it does change everything about us when we begin to renew our mind. But friend, listen to me. The real you, the spirit you, if you've been born again, you have been created in righteousness and true holiness. All right, we come to the second letter, B. It stands for baptism. Colossians 2 and verse 12. For you were buried with Christ when you were baptized, and with him you were raised to new life because you trusted the mighty power of God who raised Christ from the dead. Did you notice baptism in verse 12 came after being made new in verse 11? If you haven't been made new first, baptism will do you no good. If you haven't been made a new creation in Christ first, friend, here's how it works. You go into the water, a dry sinner, and you come out a wet sinner, unchanged. Baptism does not change you, doesn't save you. It's a declaration of what Christ has already done. You know, as a new Christian, I was out of state in a stand in a hotel, and I thought, well, maybe there's a church that's got a midweek service. And so I got a paper out, and I found an ad. It said, Pentecostal coming soon, Jesus coming soon, church. So I thought, great. I go to a little Pentecostal church back home. I got on the phone. I called them. I said, look, I'm at such and such hotel. How do I find you guys? It says, here you have a midweek service. They said, we do, but you don't need to get a taxi. We'll pick you up in the church bus. I said, really? They said, yeah, we'll be there. I said, okay. So we determined a time, and sure enough, they came in the church bus, and it was the pastor himself. Came to pick me up. I couldn't believe it. Pastor and his wife and their son. I said, thanks, guys. So we get to the church, and no one was there. I was the only one. And then the pastor's wife and his son disappeared, and it was me. And so he preached to me for the next, like, hour. I was the only one in there. And he thundered. I mean, the guy, he preached hard. But his whole message was about water baptism. And his whole deal was, if you are not water baptized according to their formula, you're going to hell. That if the guy baptizing you didn't say the words according to their formula, you were lost eternally. He preached in his message. He said, Oral Roberts may be helping a lot of people, but he's going straight to hell. He said, Billy Graham may be a good preacher, but he's going to split the gates of hell wide open because he's not baptized, you know, according to our formula. And I'm thinking, you know, I've been baptized in water, but I don't remember what the guy said. In fact, I think I was underwater. I didn't even hear him. But you know, it's stupid. It's ignorance gone to seed. Baptism will do you no good if you haven't been changed first. It's a declaration of what Jesus has already done for you. My old life is dead and buried. Now I'm raised to a new life with him, and I'm identifying with Christ. That's one reason we don't do infant baptism, because an infant, you know, can't make a declaration of what Christ has done for them. Now, we do formally dedicate children, and we lay hands on them and bless them. Jesus did that. And so we do that as well. All right, we come to the next letter in the alphabet. It's C. It stands for Christ, our identity. Christ, our identity. Colossians 2, again, verse 12, but I want to read verse 13 with it. It says, for you were buried with Christ when you were baptized, and with him you were raised to new life because you trusted the mighty power of God who raised Christ from the dead. You were dead because of your sins and because of your sinful nature. It was not yet cut away. Then God made you alive with Christ and forgave all our sins. Now, did you notice in those two verses? With Christ, with Christ, with him. There's an identification there. In baptism, we identify with him. But the only reason that has any value is because he first identified with us. My friend, in the mind of God, when Jesus died on the cross, you died with him. In the mind of God, when Christ was buried, you were buried with him. In the mind of God, when Jesus was raised from the dead, you were raised with him because he did what he did as your representative. He did it as your substitute in your place. You know, in the Old Testament high priest would go into the tabernacle. There was a section where the Ark of the Covenant was and where God's presence dwelt under the Old Testament. And the high priest was the only one allowed to go in there only one time a year. And he would go in there once a year to represent himself and all of the people of Israel. And he would go in with the blood of an animal, which he offered for his sins and the sins of the people as their representative. I want to read a few verses from Hebrews 9 that talks about it. And listen to these verses. They're powerful. Hebrews 9 and 7, it says, but only the high priest ever entered the most holy place, and only once a year. And he always offered blood for his own sins and for the sins of the people that they'd committed in ignorance. Verse 11, so Christ has now become the high priest over all the good things that have come. He has entered that greater, more perfect tabernacle in heaven, which was not made by human hands and is not part of this created world, with his own blood. Not the blood of goats and calves. He entered the most holy place once for all time and secured our redemption forever. So when he went into the holy place in heaven, into God's presence, he went with his own blood. I want to read more. Verse 24. For Christ did not enter a holy place made with human hands, which was only a copy of the true one in heaven. He entered into heaven itself to appear now before God on our behalf. And he did not enter heaven to offer himself again and again like the high priest here on earth, who enters the most holy place year after year with the blood of an animal. If that had been necessary, Christ would have to die again and again ever since the world began. But now, once for all time, he has appeared at the end of the age to remove sin by his own death as a sacrifice. Now picture it. Jesus, he's died on the cross. He's been raised from the dead. Now he's going to ascend into heaven. He enters heaven, and I see him just walking down this corridor, and every angel is standing in attention. In stunned awe and silence, because their creator, the second person of the Trinity, Jesus, has eternal scars now on his hands and his brow and his feet and upon his back. An everlasting reminder of his immeasurable love for those created in his image and in his likeness. And as Jesus walks into the very presence of the Father, he says, Father, I don't just come on my behalf. But if you accept this sacrifice in my precious holy blood, you accept Bayless. Because when I died, he died with me. When I was buried, he was buried with me. When I came up from the dead, he came up with me. I am his representative. And if you receive this, if you receive me, you receive Bayless. You receive Janet. You receive John. You receive Robert. You receive Sally. You receive David. You receive them all. Because they are in me, and I died as their representative. And the Father looked at him and said, I receive them in you. The scripture says in the book of Ephesians that we are accepted in the beloved. My friend, I'm not an outsider with God. He doesn't just tolerate me. He loves me like he loves Jesus. No, my mind cannot fathom that. Throughout eternity, I'll never be able to plumb the depths of that truth, but it is true. I have been made right with God with the righteousness of Christ. His holiness has touched me and it has changed me. And Jesus completely and totally identified with me, and the Father received him in me. Christ, my identity. You know, that is one of the most amazing thoughts, that I'm accepted in the beloved. Jesus is the beloved. I'm accepted in him. In fact, I would encourage you to go through the New Testament and look up every verse where it says, in Christ, in whom, or in him. Read those verses. They'll tell you what you have. They'll tell you what belongs to you. They'll tell you what has been provided for you in Christ. I have been made the righteousness of God in him. I am accepted in him. I can do all things through him. On and on and on. What a rich inheritance we have as believers. I honestly think we haven't scratched the surface of what is available to us in Christ. I pray that God's richest blessings would rest upon you, and look forward to seeing you again. In Jesus' name.
Next week on Answers with Bayless Conley.
And today, my friend, there are hundreds of millions of us filled with the Holy Spirit, ablaze with the gospel. We have received power from Jesus. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And we have been commissioned to go in his name. In fact, you know, the scripture says that God always causes us to triumph in Christ. We've been made part of the victory parade, my friend. His authority has been delegated to his church. Jesus said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. You go, therefore, in my name. You cast out demons. You lay hands on the sick. You preach the gospel to all of creation. And they went out and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them, confirming the word with signs following. My friend, you are the devil's biggest nightmare. If we will just wake up to what we have in Christ and believe the scriptures. Yeah, we wrestle against principalities and powers. The scripture says that in Ephesians, but I'm wrestling against a defeated foe. I'm wrestling from a position of having already won. I'm wrestling from a position of victory. I'm wrestling from a position of being in Christ and having his authority. Oh, what a difference. What a difference. It is finished.
What happens when you pray? Do your prayers come with answers? Or does it feel like God is silent? Your prayers can have an impact. You can hear God in prayer. In Bayless Conley's easy-to-read booklet, How to Pray, you'll learn how to have an effective, life-changing prayer life. Oftentimes, we simply skip over the step of inviting God into our lives through prayer, but God wants to connect with you. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and get How to Pray, you'll discover that God desires to not just hear from you, but to speak to you. You'll understand that prayer is essential to live a victorious life, and exactly how to make your prayer life a consistent and dynamic part of your relationship with God. Available in physical, digital, or audiobook formats for just $12. How to Pray will challenge you to focus on God, listen to what he is saying, and then yield to his desires for your life. When you go to BaylessConley.com and get How to Pray, you will learn the practical ways to deepen your relationship with God by using the simple framework of praise, repentance, asking, and yielding every time you pray. Your prayers can have an impact. You can hear from God in prayer. Go online right now to BaylessConley.com to get How to Pray. That's BaylessConley.com. Go online right now.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.